Good morning. Just to say for those who haven't been before, you will be able to receive Holy Communion during Mass at the front. The screen will be brought here, and the stewards will direct you to come to the front. Just wait for the stewards to direct you, and you'll come to the front. Hold your arms out straight under the screen and receive Holy Communion in silence. If you make sure that you come out of the bench in the direction that you entered it and re-enter in the same direction. And when you come to the front, if you turn towards the side that you've come from, and the stewards will direct you back to your seats. And please just keep
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Peace be with you. Welcome, brothers and sisters, to our celebration of the 29th Sunday of the year. And it's also Mission Sunday, World Mission Sunday. And throughout the whole church, people are remembering the mission of the church and those who bring the gospel to the far-off lands. Normally, there would be a second collection, but what we're going to do is I'm just going to let you know in a second or two the web address, and if you want to contribute, you can do that. Go onto their website. It's missio.org.uk/donate. missio.org.uk/donate. Our God, who is Lord unrivaled, calls upon us to follow the demands of our conscience in every single circumstances of our lives, thereby giving to God what belongs to God. The Lord loves us and has chosen us. We ask him to help us to respond to his love and to his choice. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask Blessed Mary, Ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Christ.
Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, grant that we may always conform our will to yours and serve your majesty in sincerity of heart. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God for ever and ever.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. Thus says the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whom he has taken by his right hand, to subdue the nations before him and strip the loins of kings, to force gateways before him, that their gates be closed no more. It is for the sake of my servant Jacob, of Israel my chosen one, that I have called you by your name, confirming a title, though you do not know me. I am the Lord, unrivaled. There is no other God besides me. Though you do not know me, I arm you, that men may know from the rising to the setting of the sun, that apart from me, all is nothing. The word of the Lord. First letter of St. Paul to the Thessalonians. From Paul, Silvanus, and Timothy, to the church in Thessalonica, which is in God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, wishing you grace and peace from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. We always mention you in our prayers and thank God for you all, and constantly remember before God our Father how you have shown your faith in action, worked for love, and persevered through hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. We know, brothers, that God loves you and that you have been chosen, because when we brought the good news to you, it came to you not only as words, but as power and as the Holy Spirit and as utter conviction. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. The Pharisees went away to work out between them how to trap Jesus in what he said. And they sent their disciples to him, together with the Herodians, to say, "Master, we know that you are an honest man and teach the way of God in an honest way, and that you are not afraid of anyone, because a man's rank means nothing to you. Tell us your opinion then. Is it permissible to pay taxes to Caesar or not?" But Jesus was aware of their malice and replied, "You hypocrites, why do you set this trap for me? Let me see the money you pay the tax with." They handed him a denarius, and he said, "Whose head is this? Whose name?" "Caesar's," they replied. He then said to them, "Very well, give back to Caesar what belongs to Caesar, and to God what belongs to God." The Gospel of the Lord. On July the 6th, 1535, Thomas More, one of the most illustrious Englishmen of his day, stood at the foot of the gallows on Tower Hill. He'd been condemned to death for refusing to take the oath of supremacy, which would have been to acknowledge Henry VIII as only supreme head of the Church of England. More was a scholar, the author of many learned books, a devoted public servant chosen by Henry himself to be his chancellor, a much-loved family man, deeply attached to his wife and children, and anxious that his daughters should be educated far beyond the level usually available to women in those days. He was, as C.S. Lewis wrote of him, a man before whom the best of us must stand uncovered. He had told the judges who condemned him that he prayed that he and they would all meet merrily in heaven. And even as he was mounting the rickety ladder to the scaffold, he retained his customary wit. "I pray, Lord Lieutenant," he jested, "see me safe up, and for my coming down, let me shift for myself." Then, after a few words of encouragement to the assembled crowd, he declared that he was about to die as the king's good servant, but God's first. The king's good servant, but God's first. Those words might serve as a commentary on what our Lord says in today's gospel. Let's recall the situation for a moment. Jesus has come up to Jerusalem for the last time. He has already been involved in controversy with the religious leaders. Finally, the Pharisees decide to try and entrap him. They begin with honeyed words, intended, no doubt, to put him off his guard. In fact, the Pharisees don't come themselves, but send intermediaries. So it's these intermediaries who use the honeyed words. "Master, we know that you are an honest man and that you are not afraid of anyone." But after the compliments comes the barbed question, aimed to put Jesus in a no-win situation. "Tell us," they inquire, "is it permissible to pay taxes to Caesar or not?" The tax involved, a kind of poll tax, was detested by the Jews on two counts. First, because it was a painful reminder that they were a subject people. And second, because the coinage in which it was to be paid bore the head of the Roman emperor and an inscription which proclaimed him to be divine. And so if Jesus were to say that the tax should be paid, he would at once lose all credibility with the people. On the other hand, if he were to say it should not, he could then be accused of fomenting disobedience, even rebellion against Rome, and that could have literally fatal consequences. You can imagine the tension in the crowd as Jesus calmly holds up one of the well-known silver coins used for paying the tax and asks, "Whose head is this? Whose name?" Well, everyone knows the answer to those questions. The head and the name are, of course, Caesar's, the Roman Emperor's. "Very well," says Jesus, "give back to Caesar what belongs to Caesar, and to God what belongs to God." By having such coinage in their possession, they were at least implicitly acknowledging Caesar's right to tax them. However, Jesus' answer is more than an ingenious way of slipping out of the trap. By adding what belongs to God ought to go back to God, he's making a further point, that our overriding commitment has to be to God himself. Of course, we must accept lawful civil authority. Indeed, as Christians, we ought to be the best of citizens, being a good, responsible citizen, working for the common good of the community. These are our Christian duty. In that sense, already part of our giving to God what belongs to him. At the same time, we do not look to the state as our moral guide. The law may countenance abortion, for example, or the sale of arms to oppressive regimes, but the fact that such activities are legal does not make them morally right. And if ever there was a genuine clash between our duties to state and our duties to God, there's no doubt where our Christian duties lie. It's God's law, not the state's, that has to be the last word. Today, let's remember in our prayers all who face these stark choices, that they may courageously follow conscience, no matter what price they have to pay. And because we know that's never easy, for you and for all of us, I pray, God of creation, to you every man, woman, and child owes the breath of their existence. Earthly rulers have no splendor in comparison to your glory. Teach us to honor those who rule over us. Make us faithful and loyal citizens. The king, the queen, the state's good servant, but yours first. Guide us to worship only you, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. We stand now to profess our faith together. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father, through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead, and the life of the world to come. Amen. On this World Mission Sunday, we unite with the whole Catholic Church in praying for the coming of God's kingdom. For Pope Francis and all the leaders of the Church, may they continue to lead us in our response to God's call to mission. Lord, in your mercy, for all missionaries, men and women, dedicated to sharing the gospel of Jesus with those who have not yet received it, may they be given the strength and courage to persevere in their mission. Lord, in your mercy, for those who have not yet received the good news of Jesus Christ, may they obey his call to go forth in order to reach all those in need of the light of the gospel. Lord, in your mercy. For young and growing Catholic communities across the world, especially the Church in Malawi, may our prayers and charity give them courage to persevere in their mission of proclaiming the gospel. Lord, in your mercy. For those who live in areas of war, poverty, and injustice, may we help to heal wounds, build bridges, strengthen relationships, and bear one another's burdens. Lord, in your mercy. For those who are suffering, grieving, and anxious, help us to strive together as one family of many nations to help those in greatest need. Lord, in your mercy. God our Father, your Son, Jesus Christ, calls us to be missionary disciples. May your church so abound in love and compassion that the joy of the gospel will fill the hearts and lives of all who encounter Jesus. We ask this through the same Christ our Lord. Amen. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Grant us, Lord, we pray, a sincere respect for your gifts, that through the purifying action of your grace, we may be cleansed by the very mysteries we serve. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For in you we live and move and have our being. And while in this body, we not only experience the daily effects of your care, but even now possess the pledge of life eternal. For having received the first fruits of the Spirit, through whom you raised up Jesus from the dead, we hope for an everlasting share in the Paschal mystery. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. Through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Save us, Saviour of the world, for by your cross and resurrection you have set us free. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Luke, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, me, your unworthy servant, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honour is yours forever and ever. At the Saviour's command, and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign for ever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. The body of Christ. The blood of Christ. Especially for those at home, we make our spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the holy sacrament of the altar. I love you above all things, and I passionately desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, come spiritually into my soul, so that I may unite myself wholly to you, now and forever. Amen. Let us pray. Grant, O Lord, we pray, that benefiting from participation in heavenly things, we may be helped by what you give us in this present age and prepared for the gifts that are eternal, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Just remind you again that if you wanted to donate to Missio, go online, missio.org.uk/donate, and you can donate to the World Mission collection today. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you all, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your lives.